Okay. The problem, and this is a very difficult problem, because music speaks far more powerfully than words or images. Now, we are slightly biased, and I am talking. And I wanted to first, before we get into this incredible Haydn quartet at the height of his powers, I want to say, explain why. Why is that guy up there on stage talking? It has a long history, and it's based on two basic premises. One is a very general one, and it goes something like this. As an example, I'm on an airplane, I have my violin set up, and somebody comes up to me, total stranger, what's in there? You got a gun or, you know, making conversation? Trombone? No, it's a violin. Oh, what do you do? Oh, I'm in a string quartet, on tour. What kind of music do you play? You play, you know, the traditional answer is classical music, and then that often draws forth a response of, oh, I love classical music. It's so relaxing. I put it on at home when I get home from work if I'm really tired. It's just, I fall asleep to that every night. It's so great. And you know that scene from Lord of the Rings where Gollum transforms into that creature and tries to strangle the person in the middle of the night? Because, in a nutshell, and it's, look, I do it too. It's not a bad thing at cocktail parties. It's fine. But to really be devastated by the genius of Haydn specifically, both performers and audiences have to be connected, have to be exploring the material in really active ways. So the difference between, as an audience, letting it wash over you and thinking about how you got a great parking spot and the meal was actually quite good, you know, to actually following the game. And another analogy I like football. And it's like going to a football game if you're from England and have no idea of the rules. You know, you sort of can understand when something good happened because people cheer, but for the most part, you're missing out on all the good stuff. And so what I want to do today, and that's one of the reasons why, I want to sort of, with my colleagues, take you through this piece, give you some things to hang on to. And I know there's some hardcore chamber music fans here who know this piece intimately. I hope there's something for you. I also know there's some non-musicians who have no idea what sonata form is and don't think they care. So we're going to meet in the middle, and hopefully at the end, when we play the piece through in its entirety to end the first half, the experience will be much more active, much more involved, and you'll get more out of it, in a nutshell. Now, two reasons I said, that's the broad generalization. The other one is specifically about Joseph Haydn, and this is where I think Muhammad Ali and Joseph Haydn writing string quartets had something in common. What, you may ask? They were both the greatest of all time. Seriously, though, it's totally true. And we forget, Beethoven gets all the credit for being this devastating innovator and creating these new worlds. Totally, it was all Haydn. Mozart gets all the credit for writing these great tunes, and he did. Great opera composer. He could not write a string quartet even close to as well as Joseph Haydn, and he would be the first to admit it. So Haydn gets a short stick, and we're sort of evangelical about trying to change that, whether it be just playing his music as much as possible, talking to students about what it means and how to present it in a way which will be engaging. We'll reach out and say, check this out. And so it's sort of our mission. I do feel especially evangelical today with my little lap mic here. So that's the plan. We're going to go through, we're going to give you some signposts, we're going to hopefully have some moments of wow that will then translate to the whole playthrough. And I wanted to end this portion of the program by thank yous, two of them. The first is to your fearless leader, Sarah Rothenberg, for stepping out on a limb. Yeah. I know you may still be thinking, She hired some guy to come and talk about Haydn quartets? Oh, man, that's going to be deadly. And the second and equally important thank you is to my colleagues in the St. Lawrence String Quartet, Mark, Chris, and Leslie, because, of course, string quartet is the ultimate democracy. We're totally equal partners in this, but they're going to sit mute the entire first half. Oh! So I just want to say they've been really cool with this. It just makes things, anybody wants to come back, they can speak equally eloquently and in some ways, well, more intelligently about Haydn than I can. Come back and meet them after the show. I encourage you. So those are my two thank yous. Okay, the Emperor. Haydn had returned from London. He was a total rock star. It's hard to overestimate how huge a star he was. By far the most famous musician in the world at this point. And he came back and he could write whatever he wanted to in the mid to late 1790s. He chose, for the most part, to focus on writing The Creation, one of the great masterpieces, and all the late great masses, the Nelson Mass, for example. But luckily, he also chose to express himself in the string quartet, a form specially close to his heart. It really allowed him to express all of his capriciousness, his wit and humor, but also his deep emotional connection on a really intimate level, which we often don't give him credit for. Don't take my word for it, though. Mozart and Haydn were very close, and they actually played quartets together for fun. How'd you like to be at that dinner party? You know, they'd have great description. They have dinner, and then the guys would get together, Van Hall and Dittersdorf and Mozart and Haydn. They would read quartets of each other's, and it must have been amazing. But Mozart adored Haydn, and it worked both ways. Here's what Mozart said about Haydn. I want to get this right. He could amuse, shock, arouse laughter and deep emotion as no other. So if Mozart gets it, we should all get it equally. And I think it's safe to say, of the 68 Haydn string quartets, 50 of them are total masterpieces. You could pick one at random and be amazed and moved by the genius of expression. The Opus 76 set from 1796 and 1797 was almost the culmination, musically speaking, of all the elements of Haydn's writing that so far for quartet. Everything comes together in a perfect storm. And it really, it gets different with Beethoven. It doesn't get better. So, here's our first movement. When you just heard the exposition, the main body of the work, sort of introducing our main characters. And the whole movement, this is Haydn's longest sonata form first movement, is based on this melody. Okay, I want to do, just to get you in the spirit of this, one of the great things about Haydn, he takes seemingly insignificant material and crafts masterpieces out of it. He couldn't write a tune like Mozart. He couldn't shock with speed and volume like Beethoven. But he could amaze by creating exquisite masterpieces from seemingly innocuous material. Here's a version of that theme in a much more simplified, I mean, it couldn't be more milquetoast. It's a lovely thing. You would put that on in your cocktail party to lull your guests into a... And as I was preparing this, it's especially ironic that I'm here in Texas. I was brought to a tune that is seared in my memory from my childhood. It has a lot of similarities to this. I bet some of you knew. A lot of the camera staff did not know this tune. Okay, so I know it's a combination of booze and cheers. I grew up in College Station, so that's the Aggie fight song. That was seared in my memory. Yeah, and it has a very similar form to the theme of this first movement of the Haydn Quartet. Four parts, simple, up and down, close at the end, almost identical. Any composers out there? Aggie fight song as basic premise for a sonata form string quartet movement. I sense a commission, the camera people. So, check this out, though. Here's what Haydn does. He takes a very simple concept and breaks it up into four distinct cells or specific areas. Each one has its own totally different genetic material. Here's our first cell. We'll call that home. Just listen to that again. That's the basis of this whole first movement is this first cell. Now, the challenge when you listen to the whole movement is not to hear that opening as just a lovely melody,
but as four distinct parts, each of which has the possibility of becoming something really interesting later on. So for example, listen to what happens to that cell later on, beginning at the end of the exposition. Now, this is where I learn about you. How many people could make that connection and hear that was the same genetic material? Yeah, good, honest. And how many people thought that was totally unrelated in every possible way? Yeah, don't be shy. Yeah, no, it's a really interesting and an excellent response. Chris is going to take you through, and this is inside the mind of both Haydn as a composer and the St. Lawrence Quartet when we're trying to figure this stuff out to show it to you. So here's the topic in a fast, loud version. Remember? Same rhythm, same shape, starting on a different pitch. Now, he makes it soft, and he makes it not as sharp. He slurs it through. It's like this slightly quieter twin brother. And we get this. So the transformation of material. And one of the cool things about Haydn is that juxtaposition of intellect and emotion. He works like a mathematician. There are no spare parts. There are no loose ends. Everything comes from something. But it's all done in a completely connected, emotional way. And that's, in some ways, what separates him from the other composers of his generation and to follow. So that's our first cell. Second cell. Lovely little cadential figure. The contrast is it's soft and short. At the end of the section, that transforms into this material. One more time, see if we can make that connection. Here's the first, second cell. Transforms into a big ending thing at the end of the section. So, what begins, ends. Inside the mind of a composer. Here's the third cell. Here's the transformation a few bars later. Everything relating back to our first topic. And the final cell, the ending material, which seems so unimportant, is this material. Now, it's just a simple cadence, done, we're home. But what Haydn decides to do is create a gigantic interval, which is the distance between the notes. So instead of, he writes, really high to really low. And that moment of virtuosity for Haydn is possibility. And he explores what could that become later on in the movement. Check this out, specifically listening to Chris near the end of this section. Now, did we hear the cello with his huge leaps and this virtuosic? Could just do it once alone, Chris, so like really good. Incredibly virtuosic. And you think, yeah, that's great. And you would think, I'm just sitting out hanging, accompanying, right? I'm just, you know, it's a hoedown, yeah? Well, remember our first, our last little cell? The same two notes, except repeated really fast. So the cool thing is, you're obviously not going to go while you're listening, especially if you've heard this for the first time. Oh, listen to how that fourth cell with the big leap in the violin turned into that sort of hoedown thing where he's playing the... You're not going to... It's not going to hit you like that. But I want you to realize how much focus and care in the producing of this music is based on all these things connecting back. And the other great thing to remember about Haydn, specifically his quartets, they reward study. They reward active listening and multiple listenings. I can't tell, we've played this piece, I don't know, 50 times in public. We still rehearse it. We still discover new and interesting things. It never gets old. Now, there's one more cool thing that happens in this section, which is somewhat surprising and really creates the whole, well, the vibe. We've been talking about minutiae, but Haydn is also working on a grand scale in this four-movement work, and he creates this incredibly exuberant feel based on the fact that he's so excited to write a piece on his anthem for Emperor Francis. We'll get there. That's the second movement. But listen to this material. After we play that first phrase, we have this discussion by the viola and the cello. Now, what's that? Everybody knows now we're listening, right? That's cell one. Remember here, cell one? You're following the game. I get it. The cello and the viola are going to play cell one, and we're going to repeat it in some way. They play it so exuberantly that it draws forth this galloping rocket figure from Mark in the second violin. He joins the band, and we suddenly enter this world of total exuberance. So, at this point, when we play through, whoops of pleasure are encouraged. You know, I'm willing to bet, especially at those concerts in London when Haydn was really the Elvis of his day, people would have gone nuts before, during, and after the performances. So if you feel a whoop coming at any point, don't be shy. But listen to how it's drawn forth. Here we go. Okay. It's just so much fun, too. It's an amazing thing. Oh. The one problem with this thing is I could go on for hours. We did this for students up at the University of Toronto, and I look over, and Chris is like, and it was like, you know, 45 minutes later, we're still on the exposition of the first movement. I'll try to avoid that. Okay, sonata form. Who knows what sonata form is? Okay, it totally doesn't matter. But again, it's a little bit like Haydn was writing this music for both players and audiences that understood the game. They knew there were four downs and you had to make 10 yards. And they understood what sonata form is. So I'm going to do a really, like, sonata form for dummies. Not that you guys are dummies. But hopefully in a way which will get you to just allow you to be in the game a little bit. Because it helps you realize how imaginative Haydn is and how he treats the sonata form. So here's sonata form in a nutshell. I'll do the movie analogy. The exposition is the first section. There are four sections. The exposition is where all the characters in the drama are sort of put forward. They're introduced to you in ways that allow you to understand them. Yeah? And then we repeat that section. We do it again, exactly the same, like at least the same note. So you can really get inside who they are, right? That's the exposition. Characters announced. Then there's the development, and that's exactly what it is. It's looking deep inside the lives of these characters, finding things you might not even want to know about them, going to places often that you didn't think were possible. And it's a really, the great composers, and Haydn could write sonata form unlike anyone else, develop material in a way which was amazing intellectually and also amazing emotionally. And you'll see that in this quartet. We go to places in the development that you would never imagine these characters would go or even think about going. So development. And then we have the recapitulation. Is that me? I hope not. I'm falling apart. The recapitulation is just simply home. Remember home? So we go on this journey. It's to places far afield. We come home, recap. And that's one of the signposts I want you to really get in your bodies. Home. Recapitulation. And then we have a coda, which sort of sums up our experience of this journey of this first movement, wraps it up in a bow tie, and we're done. So we know sonata form now, good? Excellent. You guys are quick studies. So what I want to do is just give you those signposts, so when we play the whole movement, you'll know where we are, a roadmap, so to speak. Remember our cell two? I don't think it's me.
No, I don't think so.
I'll speak loud if you want to turn it off. Yeah? Okay. Just, I think we've gotten rid of the mic, so if you can't hear, let me know.
So here's our second cell. And the whole section, the whole exposition section, ends with that as ending material. Do you want to just take a second to fix it? Like turn everything off? Okay. Ending of exposition. Let's try that again, one more time. Because that's where you look over to your colleague or spouse and say, the exposition is done. We got through that. We know all the characters now. At that point, a lot of things can happen. Now, I've already given away, we're going to repeat. But this is how we repeat. Here's that ending figure again. Expectation. And we get... back home, and we get to meet the characters all again. Are you with me? Yeah. Now, for extra credit, what happened after our cadential figure? You guys want to lay it down? So how did he get us home? What are these two notes? Remember our first cell? Just the first two notes. How silly is that? So he just takes those first two notes, the bump, bump, and that's a topic that we converse about, and that brings us home. So that's the exposition. You get to hear it again. It's very helpful, especially if you don't know this piece well. You can really get inside the characters. Here's that same ending material, and again, listening for possibility in silence. One of the great secrets about really getting into Haydn is possibility in silence. So here's our cadential figure. What could possibly happen? We know that, right? Yeah. That's our first cell, except quietly. And listen to what it draws forth. Holy smokes! Mark just went crazy. We're no longer in that sunny, ebullient, joyful, woohoo world. We're in this scary, dark place, yeah? And so, this sounds really simplistic. Major and minor, right? You think happy, sad, all that stuff. It's totally true, but it's more than that. It's like the person you thought you knew turned into something slightly horrible and disturbing. And so this whole development is an exploration of those characters that we thought were happy and having a great time. We find out that not all is well in their world. And we end up, we go to places that are, remember the second song? It becomes... Oh my God. Slightly horrible, actually. Remember that, like, joyful material, that becomes reaching up. So we go to really undiscovered country emotionally here, but all based on those four cells that we laid down at the beginning. We come out of this material, we're in this dark place, we end, the world comes to a grinding halt. That's really horrible. Now, of course, that's not what happens. And that's the genius of Haydn. Oh, I want you guys to take part in an experiment. We're going to play a somewhat well-known piece of music, and I want you all to respond. So we're going to be basically, you guys are the Wortham Quartet, and we're the St. Lawrence Quartet. We're going to do a little octet thing here. You guys ready? So you can vocalize, or you can use rhythm, either one. And try to be together.
Not bad. Not bad. It took you a while to get off the back of your chair, didn't it? Now we're really forward. We know what's coming. Let's try it again. Excellent. Very good. So, a lot of you are not musicians, but you all understand that, right? That's expectation in music. You can all answer that question. We're going to do, just now listen, you can sort of hum along if you want. Here are some examples, and that's the base level of musical expectation, right? One of Haydn's great geniuses is that he does that all the time in various ways, large and small. But just so you can understand, here are a couple different versions of our shave and a haircut. So we'll do it for real once. Okay, you know what's coming now, right? Good, you guys are right there. Another possibility of not, right? The not in Haydn is a very powerful weapon as well. Total silence. And of course, one of the other ones he uses a lot is the wrong note. So I know that's somewhat mundane, using shave and a haircut to describe expectation in music in Haydn, but it really is totally true, and what I want to illuminate for you is you can all get it in that kind of visceral way like you know shave and a haircut. So here's our devastating moment that we just played for you. We're going into the depths of despair emotionally. This crazy folk band out of nowhere, right? I mean, with the drones and the beer steins throwing and people swirling around. And this is right on top of total emotional devastation. So again, just a reminder, Beethoven gets all the credit for these shocking emotional transitions. Haydn did it way earlier, and in some ways more effortlessly. Now you may be saying, where did that come from? He just made that up, that whole, like, big party thing. That's just ridiculous. But of course, that's never true in Haydn. It always comes from somewhere. Remember this material? Right at the beginning here, crispling down the drone, and that becomes these folksy, hurdy-gurdy bagpipe things at the party tune. It's one of my favorite moments in the repertoire. And again, if you're not listening actively for possibility, if you're not living the emotional devastation of the development up until that point, it will not draw forth that exhilarating reaction of what the heck just happened. Now, of course, at that point, you're both elated and somewhat confused. Where are we? Where did we come from and where are we going? And we get an attempt. It's sort of like the after party. You had one too many, you're stumbling around looking for your glasses. One more attempt. Oh, and we're home. It feels so good to be home. Oh, man. So that sonata form sounds so dry and so boringly intellectual, but it's a real journey that if you follow along, explore with Haydn the possibilities, that moment of home will hit you like a ton of bricks, like, boy, it's great to be home. I can't believe we went to that party and we got really upset and depressed because whatever. You following me? So the idea, you know, classical period music is not romantic, totally wrong. It doesn't get more romantic in terms of being able to express something really deeply personal. Now, that's the recap. We're home. For extra credit, Haydn doesn't just lay down home exactly like it was when we described it to you originally. It's like someone snuck into your house and painted your kitchen, put a hot tub in. There's subtle differences that I challenge you to identify when we play the whole movement through. And it's a really cool thing, and it separates Haydn. A mediocre composer would say, we're home, I'm just going to lay down. The house is the same as we left it, everything's fine. Not with Haydn. He gives you little differences to be watching out for. And we end our recapitulation, we end our journey home with these two big bars of cadenzas. And of course, silence as possibility as topic. Now, what could possibly happen now? Lovely. We're back home. We're done, right? I love the topic distilled into, except way too many times. And then we have a perfect cadence, a little bow tie on our event, and it's over. Now, Schubert was born in 1797, and what happens, what Haydn lays down here is so remarkable, so shocking harmonically, that, well, I'm hoping it will draw forth a whoa. You want to try? Whoa. Now, I know I'm being totally facetious, but I think if you're really living that moment of perfect cadence, C major in our home key, we're home, everything feels good, when you get what happens, that whoa moment will hit you like a ton of bricks. In context, in 1797, this would have been, Haydn's lost his mind. It's Schubert before Schubert. So here's our, after our big cadenzas, we have our little discussion of and one. Moment. It's so cool. The last thing I'll leave you with this in this movement is that Haydn demands that we repeat the development section. Because he writes in the music, he says, la seconda volta più presto. So the music that we just played, when we go back, he asks that we play faster. So you cannot avoid. And that's why this movement is his longest sonata form movement. So here's our fast version of that, and the final cadences. We're finally back, and we end the movement. I knew this was going to happen. We rehearsed, and I'm way over time, so I'll go really fast. The reason this quartet is called The Emperor is for this movement. And when Haydn was in London, he was both amazed and jealous of the English national anthem, God Save the King. And he thought, Austria should have one of those. So when he came home, he got a commission, and he wrote this tune. An incredible combination of regalness, fragility, personal emotion. It's one of the great tunes ever composed. And Haydn, justifiably, was very proud of it. Supposedly, eyewitness accounts of him as an old man sitting at the piano playing this with tears running down his face. And it became, it's everything from national anthems to Protestant hymns. It's one of the great melodies ever composed. And when he decided to use it as a centerpiece for this quartet, He wanted to make sure he didn't mess with it. So it's a series of variations. Every one of the four instruments in the quartet get a shot at playing the tune, but it's identical each time. There's no variation in the melody itself except for the how high or low it is. And he writes specifically in the autograph, "The part carrying the melody must always be played more loudly than the others." Like, don't mess with my tune. And it's a really amazing thing, because what it shows from a compositional point of view is within those restrictions, you can't mess with the tune. Well, what can you do to vary it? And it's an orchestration clinic. It's a harmony clinic. And I think for you guys, just listening to each of the variations, you can sing along to the tune every time. And listen how different it makes you feel based on Haydn's accompaniment. It's a great lesson. I want to leave you with this last chord. It's one of those summing up the universe chords. And it's very simple, but, well, we'll just do it once. Here's how this movement should have ended. Now, Haydn adds a chord which creates such tension, and he asks that it last a long time and has a swell up and down on it. So it's both two things. It's the basic concepts of why we like Western music, tension and release. And it's also your whole week traveling before your eyes in one measure of music and finally coming to resolution. So here's how Haydn ends this movement. So after that, we return to the ebullience of the first movement with the minuet. If you really want a place to start with discovering Haydn's genius, it's his minuets. And the form is very simple. It's an A-B-A form. The A section, the first section, is repeated exactly at the end. And it's about with these restrictions of what you can do. So when we play this movement, listen for basic contrast. Remember the first movement, major, minor. Listen for expectation, what should happen and what does happen. It's subtle, but it's also incredibly powerful in how he transformed the major and minor into how it makes you feel. Now, the final moment of expectation. We get to the final movement, this four-movement structure that Haydn created, and it's a C major quartet. We should be ending with a big, ebullient C major chord, and we get devastating C minor. It should hit you like a stone in your chest. I know. A lot of the shock value of these things is sort of lost on us these days. But again, back then, that beginning would have been really devastating. So do it one more time and be a little more confused and upset by the fact that you don't have major. And then for extra credit, listen to what happens next and tell me where it comes from. I see some laughter. That's really good. Remember our first topic, the whole thing of the piece? And here it is in minor, quietly. Now, Haydn ties the quartet together in this way, using that material, that opening cell, to unify the piece. And there's reason for that. And it's in your program notes, amazingly. Have you read your program notes? G, E, F, D, C. God save Emperor Francis. In German, right? You understand the concept, right? The note value, the note name is a letter, and he spells out God save Emperor Francis. So those notes, which start the piece, which form the tune for the minuet, which appear in minor at the beginning of the last movement, sum up the centerpiece of this work as this amazing anthem he wrote for Emperor Francis in a musical way. And again, you'd never know that by listening to it, unless you're a total genius. But always give more credit to Haydn than you think he deserves. It will never be, well, misguided, shall we say. Okay, you guys want to stretch maybe? Because we're going to play the piece now. We're going to play the party music from the first movement just quickly, and you can just do a little stretching. Okay, here we go. Oh, boy, I think we could use it. You don't even have to stand up. You want to stand up? I thought you guys would be dancing with us in the aisles. Oh, man. Okay, stretch in your seats. We'll be back in 30 seconds, and we'll lay down the whole piece for you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.